أما بعد، فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم: ويقول الذين كفروا لست مرسلا قل كفى بالله شهيدا بيني وبينكم ومن عنده علم الكتاب. صلوات الله عليه وسلم. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our azah of Amir al-Mu'mineen, especially during the days of fasting. Many of you were there last night, as well as after Zuhr program and again here. And the ajr and reward is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah. This is the last in the series of talks that I had planned on the topic of Ali in the words of Ali. And what I would like to do tonight is talk about two more examples from his own sayings. And one is actually about the issue of the position of Ali as Imam in the Islamic faith. The position of Ali as far as imamate is concerned is so pivotal that without him, Islam will lose its right bearings. Although I'm putting in these words, but these are actually the words of Amir al-Mu'mineen. In one of the early khutbas, which he issued after the Muslims accepted him as their Khalifa and their leader, there is a khutbah where he actually talks about a review of the last three administrations of the Khilafat. And in a way, he uses some very critical words about all three administrations, what happened. And that is actually, in Nahjul Balagha, it is sermon number 3, in the very early parts of Nahjul Balagha. And Sayyid Razi basically has given that khutbah in its entirety. But of course, Sayyid Razi doesn't give the sanad. There is no chain of narration about it. And therefore, many people say, oh, you know, because there is no sanad, we can't really accept it. But there is a sanad for that khutbah. If you look at a scholar who came two generations before Sayyid Razi, Sheikh Saduq. So generation-wise, time-wise, you have Sheikh Saduq. His student is Mufid. And the student of Mufid is Sayyid Razi. Sayyid Razi is the compiler of Nahjul Balagha. And you will see that, you know, Sayyid Razi in the third khutbah, this is the first paragraph of that khutbah. On the other side, you will see the same khutbah from Sheikh Saduq with the sanad. From him, you know, going to Muhammad bin Ali, Majalawi, all the way going to Abdullah ibn Abbas, who was present there, and he actually has some remarks at the end of the khutbah about it. And so as far as the sanad and authenticity of this khutbah is concerned, you know, this is not, you know, open for any arguments. Of course, his language is very critical, and that is because he wanted to make things very clear that I am actually inheriting a system which has a lot of problems. And I'm going to initiate reforms which you will not like. And that is where you see Jamal and Safin and Nahrawan. These are all a reaction to the reform movement of Ali bin Abi Talib. Right in the beginning there, he says, أَمَّا وَاللَّهِ لَقَدْ تَقَمَّصَهَا إِبْنَ أَبِي قَهَافَ. Although this is not relevant to my theme, but I'll just give the example before I go to the second sentence. He says, by Allah, the son of Abu Qahafa, referring to the first Khalifa, لَقَدْ تَقَمَّسَهَا. تَقَمَّسَ from qamis. You know what is qamis? Shalwar qamis. You know the shirt. And the word taqammasa here in Arabic is used, you know, for a person who dressed himself with a shirt which was not fitting him. So Ali says that the son of Abu Quhafa dressed himself with it, referring to the Khilafat, while he certainly knew, وَإِنَّهُ لَيَعْلَمُ أَنَّ مَحَلِّ مِنْهَا مَحَلُّ الْقُطْبِ مِنَ الرَّحَى. While he very well knew that my position to Imamat and Khilafat is like the position of the axis in relation to the handmill. These words, innahu layalamu, is very important. Some of, you know, the people who say, well, maybe these things were not clear. Ali says he knew. He very well knew what is my position as far as imamat and khilafat is concerned. And he uses the example that imamat and khilafat is like the handmill, chakki. You know, in the old days, when they wanted to grind things like, you know, wheat and others to make it into flour, the grains, this is how, you know, people would use the handmill. They didn't have, you know, processing machines like we have these days. And if you look at the pictures, or if you go to the east sometimes in the villages, you will still see that the handmills are basically two stones of similar shape and size, which are placed on one another. And the difference is that the one which is on the top has a hole in between, in the middle of it. And the one which is in the bottom has actually an axis, you know, or a pillar. And the top one is placed in it, in that hole in between. Why is that axis important? Because when then they go around, you know, grinding the grains there, you know, the movement of the stone on the top will not be, the rotation will not be proper if that axis was missing. Otherwise, the stone at the top will go sideways here and there, and it will not work properly. Ali says, I am that pivotal, you know, position in imamat. If you don't have that, then the system of imamat and khilafat will not be able to function properly or efficiently. And then he says, ينحدر عني السيل ولا يرقى علي الطير. He says, you know, the flood actually flows down from me. And the bird cannot fly up to my level. These are all poetic words he's talking about. He says, you know, basically describing himself as a very tall mountain, which has the source of water there, and the water is flowing down. He says, the benefit and the wisdom and the knowledge comes from me. It flows from me. In response to another statement where he has, in response to the letter that Muawiyah wrote to him, you know, Amir al-Mu'mineen comes to a point, it's a very interesting letter, but for some other time, inshallah. We have talked about it previously, where Ali says that, you know, I hesitate to praise myself. So he goes into praising the Ahlul Bayt in general, and specifically Fatima, Hassan, Hussein, and Hamza, and Ja'far. But when it comes to himself, he says, you know, I'll just leave you with one word, one sentence. And he says, you know, for you it's enough to know. فَإِنَّ صَنَايَ رَبِّنَا وَالنَّاسُ بَعْدَ صَنَايَ عَلَنَا. That we are the direct recipients of the favors of our Lord, while others receive the favors from us, through us, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so when he's talking about, you know, that I am the central point, the pivotal point, this is not only the issue of knowledge and wisdom and leadership, it is also when it comes to the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so he says, I am that flood which is flowing from the top of the mountain. And by saying that, لا يرقى إليّ الطير, you know, no bird cannot reach to me. Basically, he's saying that I am such a tall mountain that even the most powerful bird cannot reach me. They can try, but they will never be able to reach to my position and my status. Salawat parne ek baar aur. Of course, when he says bird, he doesn't mean birds. Many tried to reach his level, and they were humiliated. There is another very interesting, you know, conversation of this type. And let me start with Sahih Bukhari here. Sahih Bukhari, in the narration of the peace treaty that the Prophet signed with the Mushrikeen of Mecca, has a discussion there where just one sentence from there, where he says to Ali, "Anta minni wa ana minka." Remember yesterday we talked about Surah Barat. That Jibreel came down and he said to Rasulullah that either you take this Surah Barat to the Mushrikeen of Makkah to announce it, or Rajulun minka, or somebody who is from you. This is another incident where the Prophet is saying, "Anta minni, O Ali, you are from me. Wa ana minka, and I am from you." The first one is easy to understand, just like the famous statements, you know, Husaynun minni wa ana min Husayn. The first one is very easy to understand. The second one is the where you have to think about it. Ahmad bin Hanbal also in his Musnad says the same statement from Rasulullah, where he says, "Aliyun minni wa ana minhu." Ali is from me and I am from Ali. This relationship is so important that you cannot separate them. That is where when we say, you know, "Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa Muhammadun Rasulullah wa Aliyun waliullah wa khalifatuhu bila fasl." You can't separate there and have, you know, one, two, three in between. No. It is Rasul, and then bila fasl, immediately then the successor is Ali. First time after the wafat of Rasulullah, and this is again the early days of Khilafat, when the people accepted him as the Khalifa, he comes into the masjid and sits on the minbar of Rasulullah. These minbars are different. This is what we just call symbolically. But that was actually the minbar of Rasulullah, the real one. As soon as he went on the minbar and he sat down, فَسَمِعَ مِنَ النَّاسِ زَوْضَاعَ, he started hearing murmuring from the people. And, you know, so he says, فَقَالَ مَا هَذِهِ الَّذِي أَسْمَعُهُ, what is it that I'm hearing? I just came and sat down on the minbar and people are murmuring. What is this? He was told, لِسْعُودِكَ إِلَى مَوْضِعِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ الَّذِي لَمْ يَسَعَدُهُ الَّذِي تَقَدَّمَكَ. They say people are actually protesting, questioning that you got onto the minbar and went and sat on the step that Rasulullah used to sit. While the first Khalifa, when he came for the first time on the minbar, he decided to sit one step below where Rasulullah used to sit. When the second Khalifa's time came, he used to sit even one more step below that of Abu Bakr. And when the third Khalifa came, he used to sit in the even further down, one more step. Amirul Mu'minin goes there, first time, goes into the minbar right away at the top. And this is where the Ummah is saying, oh, what is this? This is almost 24 years after wafat of Rasulullah. Look at the answer now. When now he is told why people are, you know, talking to one another, there is murmuring going on, you know, he responds. And his response is, سَمِعْتُ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ يَقُولُ. He says, I heard the Prophet saying, مَنْ قَامَ مَقَامِ, whoever stands in my place, whoever takes my place, وَلَمْ يَعْمَلْ بِعَمَلِي, and doesn't act according to my sunnah and my actions, أَكَبَّهُ اللَّهُ فِي النَّارِ, Allah will throw him into the fire of Jahannam. وَعَنَا وَاللَّهِ, and by Allah, as far as I am concerned, أَلْعَامِلْ بِعَمَلِهِ, I act according to the actions of Rasulullah and his sunnah. Al-mumtasilu qawluhu, I implement his instructions and his sayings. Al-hakimu bihukmihi, and I give verdicts according to the judgment of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Falidhalika qumtu huna, therefore I am sitting and taking this place of Rasulullah. Salawat. And so Ali actually physically demonstrated, you might create gap between me and Rasulullah, but I'm telling you no. Aliyun minni wa ana min aliyin. This narration that I just quoted, this is from Manaqib of Ibn Shahr Ashub, and he interestingly has combined this narration with the story of the conquest of Mecca, which is a symbolic meaning, which is very interesting, that when the Prophet, you know, was able to gain control of Mecca, one of the first things he does after going into Masjid al-Haram was to remove all the idols which were inside. And when once all the idols had been removed, there was one big one on the roof of the Kaaba. So Rasulullah told Ali, let's go and remove this one. Now the roof of the Kaaba is not that, you know, short. It is, the ceiling is high there. And so at the end, what happens, Rasulullah says, okay, Ali, get on my shoulders. Remember, Muslims believe that the seal of Nubuwwat and Khatamiyat was on there. And Ali gets on the shoulders of Rasulullah to go on the top of the Kaaba, and then he threw down the Kaaba. He threw down the idol. There were others actually who were saying, I wish we had this honor to do that. And Rasulullah says the honor goes only to the one who never ever worshipped an idol. Because most of the majority of the Sahaba were all mushrikeen before. And that is why you'll see that the Muslim world says that Ali, when they used to describe him, they would say, Karramallahu wajhu. Karramallahu wajhu means, may Allah honor his face. Because this forehead of Ali has never ever bowed down in front of an idol. Combining the story of, you know, removing the idol from the roof of the Kaaba, and Ali standing on the shoulders of Rasulullah, with this issue of sitting on the minbar, you know, in a way, Ibn Shahr Ashub is trying to say that, you know, if Ali can stand on the shoulders of Rasulullah, what problems do you have that if Ali sits on the same level as the member of Rasulullah? Salawat Manik Bara. Before Wahhabism became powerful with this, you know, petrodollars, Sunnis in general, their writers, their speakers, whenever they talk about Ali, they will say Karramallahu wajhu, or they will say Alayhi Salam. But after Wahhabism started to spread and have their influence in the Sunni world, you know, the muftis go around saying that, you know, this is, you are being unfair to other Sahaba. You shouldn't say Karramallahu wajhu to Ali or alayhi salam. You should say to all of them radiyallahu anhu. And if you look at really, the Wahhabis call themselves Salafis. Salafis means those who follow the first generation of Islam. And all others, they are saying they are bid'ati. They invented things, added things into it. But if you go back into history, and I have prepared some, you know, list of some of the, from the books that we have, we can do the search. You know, when you look at the historians, people like Tabari, Ibn Sa'ad, Maqdisi, Ibn Qutayba, Ibn Athir, Bayhaqi, Ibn Khaldun, Baladhuri, Al-Dhahabi, and many others. And these are all those who lived in the first 10 centuries of the Islamic history. They use the name, the title, Karramallahu wajhu, after the name of Ali. Even if you look at the books of Hadith, you know, you will see Musnad of Abdullah bin Mubarak, Musnad of Ahmad bin Hanbal, Sahih Bukhari itself, Sunan Abu Dawood, Sunan Nisa'i, and Sunan Dar Qutni, and many others. The first three generations of the Muhaddiseen, they actually use this dua after the name of Ali alayhi salam. So to say alayhi salam or to say karramallahu wajhu is not a bid'ah. This is the salaf. If you really want to go back to the early generation of Islam, this is the way the Muslims used to respect Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wasalam. Salawat. In Sermon 197, he says, "Wa'ana wallah," when he says here regarding this issue of minbar, that I am following the sunnah of Rasulullah and the verdicts of Rasulullah. In that khutbah, he says, "Walaqad alim al mustahfaduna min ashabi Muhammad," the companions of Muhammad who have retained the events of the days of Rasulullah, they know. أَنِّي لَمْ أَرُدُّ عَلَى اللَّهِ وَعَلَى رَسُولِهِ سَاعَةَ قَتُّمْ. They know that I never ever, even for a moment, opposed Allah or Rasul. And at the end he says, فَمَنْ ذَا أَحَقُّ بِهِ مِنِّي حَيًّا وَمَيِّتًا. I was with Rasul, supporting him, sacrificing my own life for him whenever the opportunity would come to defend him. And he says, I am the first, last one who got the opportunity to be with him when his last breath was coming out. I was the one who gave ghusl, and the malaika were helping me. And he says, so who can be more closer and more rightful to get to take that position after Rasul during the time when he was alive as well as after his wafat? Salawat. But unfortunately, you know, as Rasulullah had said, Ya Ali, la yuhibbuka illa mu'min wa la yubghidhuka illa munafiq. Islam suffered at the hand of the munafiqeen, the hypocrites. And the sign of the hypocrites is that they have hatred towards Ali. Just think about it. Ali is not only the cousin of Rasulullah, he is not only the son-in-law of Rasulullah, now he is the Khalifatul Muslimin. He is the ruler of the one-fourth of the inhabited area of the earth at that time. But why? How was his funeral taken out? Not even 50 people were there. Why? It was done at night time. He passed away in the early hours of the day. But the janazah was taken out at night. Only with family members and very loyal and trustworthy companions came, because there were people around, even in Kufa, who had this hatred against Ali. That if they would know where Ali has been buried, they would go there, dig open, you know, the grave of Ali ibn Abi Talib and mutilate his body. That is the mazlumiyat of Amirul Mu'mineen. And this is what I said yesterday in Urdu also, that the Muslims have dealt with the family of Rasulullah in a very unjust manner. When the daughter dies in Medina, she is buried at the night time. With whom? Only Banu Hashim are there. Very few companions were there. Because of the hurt that Fatima had, you know, felt from the people. She didn't want them to come there. And we see the same situation here. That the Ahlul Bayt were afraid that, you know, people will even try to express their hatred towards Ali even after his burial. And so the funeral is done in a very private manner, whether it is Fatima in Medina or there is Ali in Kufa. This is the Khalifatul Muslimin. And actually the narration that I just saw today, You know, next morning, three coffins were actually sent out, empty ones, in three different directions, just to confuse the enemies. And there were four graves dug in Kufa by the Ahlul Bayt, in the normal graveyard, not where Ali was buried, so that they wouldn't actually know where it was. You know, I remember the event of Fatima Zahra. Even after her burial, Amir al-Mu'mineen actually just made some signs of as if they were freshly, you know, buried graves there. Because next day, some people came that we were deprived from doing namaz janaza. We will dig open the grave of Fatima. Ali is the one who took out the sword. That was the mazlumiyat of Fatima. This is the mazlumiyat of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali bin Abi Talib. Azadaran Hussein. Amir al-Mu'mineen ne jo apne aakhri wasiyatein ki hain, Imam Hassan se yahi kaha tha ki dekho wo hunut jo Rasulullah ke liye istemal hua tha aur uske baad وہ جو فاطمہ کے لیے استعمال ہوا تھا اس کا کچھ حصہ جو ہے ابھی باقی ہے اور ہم لوگوں کے ساتھ آیا ہے وہ اس سے ہمیں حنوط دینا اور حسن اور حسین دونوں سے کہا کہ تم ہمیں غسل دینا اور غسل اور کفن کے بعد یہ جنازہ جو ہے تاریکی شب میں اٹھایا جاتا ہے حسن تھے حسین تھے عبداللہ بن جعفر تھے محمد حنفیہ تھے عباس تھے گھر کے جتنے جوان مرد تھے اور یہ سب موجود تھے جناب سلمان جوان ساسہ بن سوہان اور دوسرے جو قریبی اسبغ بن نباتہ جو قریبی اصحاب تھے یہ لوگ بھی موجود رہے اور امام نے جس طرح سے کہا تھا کہ دیکھو جب ہمارے تابوت کو اٹھانا تو صرف آخری دو حصے ہیں اس پر ہاتھ رکھنا اور سامنے کی طرف کچھ مت کرنا ہے اس لیے کہ ملائکہ ہوں گے اور جس طرف وہ لے جائیں تم ان کے ساتھ ساتھ چلنا یہ شہر سے دور جاتے ہیں جسے آج ہم نجف کہتے ہیں کوفہ الگ تھا نجف ایک شہر نہیں تھا اس زمانے میں وہاں جا کے قبر تیار ملی ہے اور حسن اور حسین اور اہل بیت نے امیر المومنین کو وہاں دفن کر دیا دفن کرنے کے بعد ساسہ بن سوہان جو امیر المومنین کے ایک صحابی تھے خطیب بھی تھے اور شاعر بھی تھے انہوں نے دفن کرنے کے بعد علی کے قبر کی مٹی کو اٹھاتے ہیں اور اپنے سر پر رکھتے ہیں دوسرا ہاتھ جو ہے سینے پر رکھتے ہیں اور پھر ایک مرثیہ پڑھنا شروع کیا جہاں علی کے فضائل کو بیان کیا اور کہتے ہیں لقد تاب مولدک اے علی آپ کی ولادت کی جگہ بھی طیب و طاہر تھی اور آپ کی زندگی میں بھی آپ نے صبر سے کام لیا جہاد سے کام لیا کامیاب رہے رسول کی ہمیشہ نصرت کی اور دنیا کے اس معاملے میں خداوند عالم کے ساتھ فست و رب الکعبہ کے عنوان سے آپ کامیاب ہو جاتے ہیں عزدار اور حسین ان تب فضائل کو بیان کرنے کے بعد جب امیر المومنین کے اس پرسے کو ختم ہوا اس وقت ساسہ بن سوہان نے جا کے حسن اور حسین کو پرسہ دیتے ہیں عبداللہ بن جعفر کو پرسہ دیتے ہیں محمد حنفیہ کو پرسہ دیتے ہیں جناب عباس کو پرسہ دیتے ہیں اس طرح سے اصحاب نے بنو ہاشم کو وہاں پرسہ دیا اور پھر یہ چھوٹا قافلہ جو ہے واپس آتا ہے گھر پہنچتے ہیں بس ایک جملہ کہنا چاہیں گے مولا آپ کی تدفین میں آپ کے اولاد وہاں موجود تھی اصحاب موجود تھے
سعث بن سوہان نے ایک قبر کی مٹی اٹھائی اس لیے کہ آپ کو دفن کیا گیا تھا اور سر پر لگائی ہے، لیکن ہاں وہ زین العابدین جو آپ کے تدفین میں بھی شریک تھا کم سے نہیں تھا، لیکن اس نے منظر کو دیکھا ہے جب کربلا سے روانہ ہوا، عجب نہیں کہ یاد کیا ہوگا دادا آپ کی تدفین کس طرح سے ہوئی، ہم اپنے بابا کے لاشے کو زمین کربلا پر بے غور و کفن چھوڑ کے جا رہے ہیں۔
لعنة الله على القوم الظالمين، سيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون۔ خداوند اس خلی بات قبول فرما، ہمارے گناہوں کو بخش دے، ہماری توفیقات میں اضافہ فرما۔ خداوند شیعان علی جہاں بھی ان کو اپنے حفظ امان میں رکھ، تکفیری افواج کے تمام صلاحیتوں کو نیست و نابود فرما، امام کے ظہور میں تعجل فرما۔ ربنا تقبل منا انک انت السمیع العلیم۔ ماتم وسلم۔